Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Superbugs, An Arms Race Against Bacteria by William Hall, Anthony McDonnell, and Jim O'Neill. Narrated by Matthew Lloyd Davies. Forward. Sally Davies. As a doctor, I had been aware of the problem of antimicrobial resistance and drug-resistant infections for many years, but I did not begin to fully understand the rising global scale of the challenge until, in my role as Chief Medical Officer for England, I prepared an annual report on antimicrobial resistance in 2013. Later that year, I published a book called The Drugs Don't Work, A Global Threat, to raise awareness of this scientific problem among a wider audience. And I pressed the then Prime Minister, David Cameron, to commission an independent review on antimicrobial resistance. We needed a thorough overview that would analyse the complex economic aspects of the issue and garner broader international attention. The review, which was established in 2014 and chaired by Jim O'Neill, was given the task of examining the economic and policy aspects of the problem of antimicrobial resistance, as well as outlining the scope of the problem and making recommendations for a global action plan. Its final report was submitted in May 2016. Society has taken antibiotics for granted for far too long. Over the past 70 years, they have transformed our life expectancy and our lives. Because of inappropriate use, however, in both humans and animals, drug-resistant infections have emerged and spread around the world, and existing antibiotics have become increasingly ineffective. At the same time, we have not developed new antibiotics or alternative treatments to replace them. If we do not take action now, minor injuries could be life-threatening, and the advances of modern medicine will be under threat. We are already seeing the impact of drug-resistant infections on the young, the old, pregnant women, and those with compromised immune systems. And this situation will only get worse. Cancer and its treatments generally result in patients becoming more susceptible to infection, which becomes a real problem if we do not have effective antibiotics. Although the risks of infection associated with childbirth have fallen considerably in most countries over recent decades, without effective antibiotics, the incidence of these infections could again dramatically increase in both mothers and children. We also rely on antibiotics to prevent life-threatening infections following many relatively routine surgeries, such as hip replacements and organ transplants. Drug-resistant infections threaten not only human health, but also agricultural livelihoods and food security, and therefore the whole economy. While drug-resistant infections are a major killer already, with many hundreds of thousands of people across the world dying every year, a very large number of people die from not having access to antibiotics in the first place. Those who need antibiotics should receive appropriate treatment. Generic antibiotics must still be produced, supplied, and distributed globally and affordably. But it is essential to reduce excessive use. Access, not excess, is a simple but important mantra we can use when thinking about this complex problem. The review on antimicrobial resistance was a great success, and, alongside a drive from the UK government and many others from the public, private and philanthropic sectors, it helped to galvanise international action at meetings of both the G20, Group of 20 Developed and Emerging Economies, and the United Nations General Assembly in 2016. These forums have raised awareness of the issue to the highest level, but we must recognise it is just the beginning. I will continue to do all that I can to achieve progress, including through the newly established ad hoc UN Interagency Coordination Group on Antimicrobial Resistance, of which I am a convener. This book is a vital contribution that clearly articulates the case for action and, crucially, how to do it. At the core of addressing drug-resistant infections are a number of economic challenges which must be surmounted. Superbugs has the promise to bring these economic policy solutions to a wider international audience, raising public awareness and helping to stimulate action. It also makes a convincing case for policymakers to take the next steps, and contends that we have reason to be optimistic if we are decisive now and address this complex problem with sufficient resources. We must act soon, otherwise this terrible problem will continue to worsen, and we will leave the world in a much poorer state for our children and grandchildren to come. Introduction. Bacteria live inside all of us. On average, every human body contains 100 trillion bacterial cells, 3 bacteria for every human cell. If all of these bacteria were removed, we would each lose about 2 kilograms, 4.5 pounds, in weight. Thankfully, most of these bacteria are either benign or play useful roles, such as helping us digest food. However, some of them that might be harmless in our nose or gut can be lethal in our lungs or bloodstream. Other bacteria that are not normal inhabitants of the body can also infect us, causing diseases such as tuberculosis and diphtheria. For much of human history, these kinds of bacterial infections were some of the world's biggest killers, claiming huge numbers of lives. During the late 19th and early 20th centuries, we became much better at preventing infections, but doctors still remained powerless to treat them after they started. This changed in the 1940s when penicillin, the world's first modern antibiotic, became available. Patients who had been near death were able to return to full fitness just days after taking what was often called a miracle cure. But the miracle did not last. Unlike the situation in almost every other area of medicine, antibiotics became less effective the more they were used. In response to the onslaught of penicillin and other antibiotics, drug-resistant bacteria with characteristics that protect them from attack, survived and thrived. Bacteria have now become resistant to many of the drugs in our current arsenal, and fewer new drugs are being produced. We have reached the point where scientists are warning that we face one of the greatest threats to humankind. Not only could many common infections become incurable, but a lack of effective antibiotics could effectively end much of modern medicine, since we rely on these drugs to keep us healthy during surgery and cancer treatment. A sobering example from 2016 provides a glimpse into a possible future. A woman in a hospital in the United States had a bacterial infection in her leg that was completely resistant to every available antibiotic. 26 in all. Nothing further could be done to treat the infection. Despite having access to one of the best healthcare systems in the world, the woman eventually died. In 2014, Sally Davis, Chief Medical Officer for England and author of this book's foreword, convinced Prime Minister David Cameron that the United Kingdom needed to take a leadership role on the issue. Cameron commissioned an economic review on antimicrobial resistance to look into the problem, choosing as chair the economist Jim O'Neill, one of the authors of this book. The other authors, William Hall and Anthony McDonnell, were also members of the review team. Hall was the senior policy advisor, and McDonnell was head of economic research. As economists and policymakers outside of the scientific world, we knew relatively little about this problem when we first began work on it. Working on the review, we quickly realized that to make any progress, it was essential to reach out beyond the medical and scientific world. The issue needed to be analyzed and explained from an economic perspective. The health ministries of the world got the problem. The finance ministries in general did not. Finance ministers wanted to know the answer to questions such as these. How many people currently die as a result of antimicrobial resistance, and how many more would die if we took no action? What are the economic costs both today and in the future? What policy interventions do we need to make? And how much would they cost? Who would pay for them? These were some of the questions the review on antimicrobial resistance set out to answer, and in this book, we outline the solutions to this problem through a policy and economic lens. We should mention one issue about terminology before we go any further. Note that the title of the review includes the word antimicrobial, not antibacterial. Microbe is a broad term that includes not only bacteria, but also other pathogens, viruses, fungi, and parasites, which cause diseases like HIV, yeast infections, and malaria, respectively. The problem of drug resistance affects diseases caused by all of these kinds of microbes. Hence the umbrella term, antimicrobial resistance. But in this book, we focus primarily on resistance to antibiotics that has developed in bacteria, since the problem has been known about for decades in the scientific community, but there has been insufficient international action to counter it. It is also a truly global problem that has the potential to affect every person on the planet. Many people see the main challenge for stopping drug-resistant infections as developing new antibiotics. However, this is but one part of the solution. In order to win this arms race against bacteria, we need not only to improve our tools, but also to reduce unnecessary use, so that the drugs we have will remain effective for a longer time. Antibiotics are being overused in both people and animals. Too often, people take antibiotics when they are not needed. One study from 2013 estimated that of the 40 million people who are given antibiotics for respiratory problems in the United States every year, around 27 million do not need them. When an antibiotic is prescribed in such a way that it saves a life, the risk of increased resistance is a small price to pay. But we should not be taking this risk in cases where we gain little or no curative benefit. Our farming and aquaculture systems also use excessive amounts of antibiotics, often similar drugs to those used in humans. Residues of antibiotics enter the environment in countries where antibiotics are manufactured. This flood of antibiotics drives resistance and makes our drugs less effective. We do need new drugs, but unless we use them better, they are unlikely to be useful for long. Antimicrobial resistance is often described as one of the biggest threats to humankind. But we believe that the doomsday scenarios can be averted. We can change how we buy medicines and organize healthcare in ways that can make a huge difference quickly. Increased awareness on the part of both the public and healthcare professionals can play an important role in improving the situation. A recent study by the Wellcome Trust in the United Kingdom, for example, found that most people do not know that taking antibiotics can lead to the development of drug-resistant bacteria. And if they have heard of resistance, many think that it is their body that becomes resistant to the drug, rather than the bacteria. We also need to get the word out that the problem is an urgent one today, not something that is just looming on the horizon. In response to the final report of the review on antimicrobial resistance, Mario Monti, former Prime Minister of Italy, said, "Antimicrobial resistance, an insidious and particularly devastating phenomenon, is definitely worth the urgent attention of global leaders. But it is unlikely to actually reach the leaders' agenda as a key priority, unless it is pushed up there by a compelling exercise of awareness raising, policy advocacy, and coalition building, strong enough to overcome the short-term bias of current politics." Indeed, as we demonstrate in this book, approximately 1.5 million people die every year already as a result of antimicrobial resistance. That is a huge number. It is about the same as the number of annual deaths from diabetes, and more than the number of deaths from traffic accidents. Such large numbers can be hard to imagine. And so in this book, in addition to interviewing leading politicians and international experts on antimicrobial resistance, we interview people directly affected by it. People who have lost loved ones, and those who have spent large parts of their lives treating patients and seeing the problem worsen over time. At its heart, antimicrobial resistance is a problem of economic and political failure. We need pharmaceutical companies to develop new antibiotics, but we must at the same time limit their use, which then makes it difficult for companies to recoup their investment. The current rewards-based system does not work. In this book, we combine economic policy ideas with our experience of global politics and global business investment to present workable solutions that policymakers can implement. The book is divided into two parts. Part one outlines the nature of the problem and its causes. In chapter one, we discuss how antibiotics became one of the most important discoveries in human history and how they made possible the emergence of modern medicine. We then describe in chapter two how the rise of drug resistance rendered antibiotics less effective. We present data showing just how expensive a problem it is and will be in the future, in terms of both lives lost and dollars spent. Chapter 3 reviews the economic and political factors that are behind our failure to tackle the growing threat of drug resistance. Part 2 offers a comprehensive set of solutions for antimicrobial resistance, including both how to encourage the development of new antibiotics and how to reduce their use. Chapter 4 presents our proposal for improving incentives for companies to create new antibiotics. Then we turn to prevention. As explained in Chapter 5, we can keep people healthy by getting more people to wash their hands, building sanitation systems, improving hospital cleanliness, and increasing the use and development of vaccines. These initiatives will not only keep people from getting sick, but will reduce the development of antibiotic resistance. Chapter 6 focuses on ways to reduce the unnecessary use of antibiotics through methods such as developing rapid diagnostic devices and improving global disease surveillance. We then turn to agriculture and the environment in Chapter 7, where we make suggestions for how to limit antibiotic use in animals that are raised for food, as well as encouraging manufacturers to curtail discharge of antibiotic waste. We conclude by discussing the political steps required to achieve further international action. Antimicrobial resistance is a global, multifaceted problem. The cost, both in economic terms and in human lives lost, is huge today. It will become far higher if we do not act fast. However, we can make headway by establishing the right economic and social incentives. Such large-scale incentives will require global collaboration, commitment, and expertise. The first steps have already been taken following the review on antimicrobial resistance and a declaration at the United Nations in 2016. But in many areas, there remains a need for real action to follow these strong words. Now is the time to make the investments and implement the solutions to ensure that we prevent this terrible health problem from spiraling into a global catastrophe. 1. The problem of drug resistance. 1. When a scratch could kill. For many listeners of this book, particularly those who live in high-income countries and were born after the Second World War, the fear of infectious diseases may not be a source of anxiety. Diseases like Ebola or Zika, both caused by viruses, still capture headlines. But in high-income countries, people's experiences of infectious illnesses consist mostly of occasional bouts of the common cold and other self-limiting or easily treatable infections. The perceived security, some would say complacency, that we enjoy is the product of growing up in an era when many of us enjoy ready access to effective antibiotics, the protection afforded by good healthcare, and high standards of hygiene in public and in the home. Of course, infectious diseases, both long-established ones such as tuberculosis, and more modern threats such as AIDS, remain real and pervasive threats in many parts of the world, particularly in low and middle-income countries that lack a reliable public health infrastructure and access to essential medicines. But for most of the developed world, patterns of disease have shifted profoundly over the course of the past century. In this chapter, we explore the extent to which the treatment of infectious diseases in Europe and North America has changed during the past two centuries. We consider how a series of breakthroughs in scientific research and understanding, beginning with the development of the germ theory in the late 19th century and culminating in the discovery and development of effective modern antibiotics during the first half of the 20th century, have shaped the world we live in today and laid the foundations for the crisis we face, as we find ourselves on the cusp of what Margaret Chan, former director of the World Health Organization, has described as a post-antibiotic era. The pre-antibiotic era: experiences and understanding of infection. In developed high-income countries today, the burden of infectious diseases, in terms of both disease incidence and mortality, is low. A typical adult in the United States is more likely to die of accidental or violent causes than of any type of infectious disease. In the world as a whole, non-communicable conditions, such as cancers and heart disease, cause four times as many deaths as infectious diseases. An American born in 2015 can expect to live to the age of nearly 80, while a typical 65-year-old baby boomer now approaching retirement age can expect to enjoy another 19 years of life. These statistics are in startling contrast to the life expectancy, patterns of illness, and causes of mortality in Western Europe and North America during the 19th and early 20th centuries. For example, in 1841, average life expectancy in England, then one of the most prosperous countries on earth, was just 41 years. Within that country's major cities, life expectancy was even lower. A child born in Manchester faced a meager life expectancy of 25 years. By 1900, life expectancy at birth was only 47 years. And in the United States, approximately a third of all deaths were from tuberculosis, pneumonia, or gastroenteritis. At the beginning of the 20th century in the United States, one infant in 10 died before their first birthday. For every 1,000 live births, between 6 and 9 mothers died during or shortly after childbirth. Sepsis, bacterial infection of the bloodstream, was responsible for 40% of these deaths. Following the Industrial Revolution that took place in the United Kingdom and many parts of Western Europe and North America in the 19th century, urban populations grew quickly, often resulting in squalid and overcrowded living conditions. In dense and unsanitary living quarters, with limited sewerage and access only to shared and often polluted drinking water sources, air and waterborne diseases spread easily. The poor suffered most. However, affluence and status could not completely protect people against infectious disease. An example from American presidential history concerns President Calvin Coolidge's family. On a hot afternoon in 1924, just a few days before the annual July 4th celebrations, Coolidge's two sons, John and Calvin Jr., spent the afternoon playing tennis on the White House grounds. The younger of the two, 16-year-old Calvin Jr., began to suffer pain from a blister on his toe, probably as a result of wearing his tennis shoes without socks. The blister became infected. Calvin Jr. developed a fever, and his condition rapidly deteriorated over the next few days. He was transferred to the Walter Reed Medical Center, suffering from Staphylococcus aureus blood poisoning. The president wrote in a letter to his father on July 4, "Calvin is very sick. Of course, he has all that medical science can give, but he may have a long sickness with ulcers. Then again, he may be better in a few days. Sadly, the teenager died on July 7, just a week after his game of tennis. Even privilege and access to the very best medical care of the day could offer no defense against death from an injury and subsequent infection. This poignant story is just one of many notable examples that illustrate the reality of disease in the pre-antibiotic era. Infectious diseases were a blight across all sections of society, even affecting the affluent and otherwise young and healthy. A seemingly innocuous scratch or cut truly could kill. During the 19th century, tuberculosis, TB, also called consumption or the White Plague, was a pervasive affliction. TB was common across all sections of society, especially in dense urban areas. In major European cities such as London, Paris, and Stockholm, annual mortality rates from TB were 800 to 1,000 deaths per 100,000. The disease accounted for 40% of deaths among the urban poor, with latent TB infection rates estimated at between 70 and 100% in some urban areas. The death rate among those who developed active TB infections was 80%. The best efforts to treat TB were offered by the so-called sanatorium movement, whose proponents contended that the illness could be cured through relocation to places where the air was cleaner and circulated more freely. An extended stay at a sanatorium, typically located in a mountainous, rural, or seaside location, was often prescribed for more affluent TB patients. But in reality, it offered little more than symptomatic relief from the disease. Nonetheless, considerable faith was placed in the curative ability of sanatoria, even after the discovery of the bacterium that causes TB, described later in this chapter. Although experimental treatments based on new discoveries emerged in the early 1900s, the recovery rates from TB remained persistently low, and the majority of patients treated in sanatoria were dead within 5 years of their discharge. One of the author's own family members, Joyce Pickard, spent 3.5 years of her childhood in a British hospital that specialised in the treatment of children afflicted with non-pulmonary TB. She lost the ability to walk and became permanently disabled by a severe TB infection in her hip bones. From late 1937 to the summer of 1941, she was almost completely confined to her bed in a hospital on the south coast of England. More than 200 miles from her home in Yorkshire, she had little exposure to the outside world. Without antibiotics, there was no way to treat the underlying infection effectively. Her treatment consisted of isolation and fresh air. Her bed would be wheeled outdoors even in the depths of winter, when she recalled that she would develop chilblains on her hands from the cold, and doctors would do their ward rounds while shivering in heavy overcoats. Such a protracted period of treatment and the confinement it involved seems extraordinary to us today, particularly since the disease is now both preventable and treatable. This picture of infectious disease has changed almost entirely thanks to a series of breakthroughs in our understanding of disease, and subsequently in the discovery of antibiotics to treat them. Starting in the mid-19th century, average life expectancy has increased by a greater amount and more rapidly than at any other period in human history. And this increase is attributable to the decline in infectious disease. But with the rise in antibiotic resistance potentially rendering vital treatments ineffective, are we facing a post-antibiotic era that resembles this pre-antibiotic past? The development of the germ theory. We take it for granted today that, with a few exceptions, the causes of infectious diseases are well understood. These illnesses are spread from person to person, and in the environment around us, by a pathogen of one sort or another, of which bacteria and viruses are the two most common. Bacteria are single-celled organisms that live within us and around us in vast quantities, usually benignly coexisting with us, and even helping to keep us healthy. But in certain circumstances, colonizing our bodies, multiplying uncontrollably and causing illness. Viruses, meanwhile, are particles around 100 times smaller than bacteria that penetrate our own cells and multiply within to cause diseases ranging from the common cold and influenza to rabies and Ebola. But these facts have not always been known, and it was only a series of significant breakthroughs during the late 19th and early 20th centuries that allowed scientists to properly understand the causes of many infectious diseases. Before the middle of the 19th century, people recognized that diseases like cholera were contagious, that is, they spread within a population. But the cause of the contagion was unknown. Many theories emphasized the role of miasmas, foul-smelling vapors that were thought to transmit disease, exacerbated by environmental conditions and proximity to filth. Such theories did account for certain key characteristics of the diseases. In the case of cholera, for example, areas hit by outbreaks would be dogged by foul stenches and conditions, and disease outbreaks were more likely to occur during hot summer months than in the cold of winter. However, the source of the contagion was often misidentified. For instance, conventional wisdom blamed typhoid on fecal contamination and poor personal hygiene, but little attention was paid to the role of contaminated drinking water or food. Another common hypothesis stated that some kind of predisposition, whether by birth or acquired through an individual's environment and circumstances, was crucial to the development of the disease, downplaying the importance of exposure to the infection and how it occurs. All of these ideas changed with the emergence of the germ theory, which posited that living microorganisms cause infectious diseases. One of the founders of the germ theory was Louis Pasteur, a chemist who taught in Lille in northern France in the mid-19th century. Lille was in an agricultural region and was the centre for the industrial fermentation of sugar beets into alcohol. Pasteur became interested in the process of fermentation, and by means of a high-resolution microscope, he was able to observe and identify the different microorganisms responsible for fermentation and putrefaction in food. He realized that microorganisms got into food through contamination from the environment, not, as had been thought, through a spontaneous decay process. This discovery highlighted the fact that microorganisms originated from the outside, not the inside. Could the same process, exposure to microorganisms, be responsible for certain diseases? The other founder of germ theory is Robert Koch, a German physician and biologist. In the late 1870s, Koch published his investigations into bacteria as disease-causing microorganisms. He demonstrated the process by isolating pathogens from diseased animals and inoculating the pathogens into healthy animals, showing how diseases could be transmitted. In 1882, Koch successfully isolated the tuberculin bacillus, which he claimed to be the cause of all tuberculosis illness. This marked a significant step forward in the understanding of the cause and mechanism of transmission of TB. In 1854, around the same time as Pasteur's early work on microorganisms, a London-based physician named John Snow did pioneering work on cholera that elucidated the source of a major cholera outbreak in London's Soho district. Snow rigorously tracked and mapped cases as the outbreak emerged and demonstrated that a cluster of cases occurred around a particular water source, a shared pump. The data supported his theory that cholera was transmitted in drinking water. He staged a stark intervention by persuading parish authorities to remove the pump handle to take it out of service, an act that slowed the spread of the outbreak. His action provided compelling circumstantial evidence that the water source had played a role in the outbreak, establishing Snow's position as the founder of infectious disease epidemiology. Another important innovator was Joseph Lister, a British surgeon. Lister became interested in the implication of Pasteur's findings for patients with wounds that became infected after surgery. Drawing on Pasteur's conclusions that putrefaction was caused by contamination with microorganisms from the environment and the open air, Lister began experimenting in the 1860s with using antiseptics to clean and souse wounds during surgery, producing sharp reductions in postoperative infections. Lister's work was one of the first instances of the application of Pasteur's ideas to human medicine. Early interventions to reduce the infectious disease burden. These discoveries and the growing acceptance of the germ theory played a crucial role in attempts to prevent and treat infectious diseases during the second half of the 19th century. Most notable were what Sally Davis, Chief Medical Officer for England, and others have categorized as the first wave of recognizable public health interventions. Programs offering basic interventions to protect the population's health, including vaccinations and the construction of effective sanitation infrastructure. The introduction of proper sanitation in Europe's growing cities, exemplified by the construction of London's first modern sewage system during the 1860s, is one of the most significant of these interventions, offering increased protection from waterborne risks. Similarly, interventions such as vaccination programs and the pasteurization of milk became increasingly common during the second half of the century, directly driven by the work of Pasteur and other originators of the germ theory. Although the effect of these interventions was significant, some scholars, especially Thomas McKeown, have argued that improvements in health had already emerged during the first half of the 19th century, and that the most important factor in this improvement was the rising affluence of the United States and Western Europe, and associated improvements in living conditions and nutrition. In any case, it appears that the greatest gains in population health were appearing before the advent of effective antimicrobial drugs, thanks to large-scale interventions to reduce people's exposure to the agents that were now known to be causing disease. The birth of the antibiotic era. With the emerging understanding of germ theory and the nature of infectious diseases, there was a shift in medical treatment. As the role of microbes in disease gained currency, so too did the notion of a medicinal magic bullet, a drug that could selectively target a pathogen and cure disease. Early breakthroughs in the hunt for a magic bullet. One of the first breakthroughs in the search for a magic bullet developed out of an exploration of toxic substances that could be used to target microbes, such as the one that causes syphilis. Like Pasteur, many of the scientists involved in this research were working in industrial environments. One of the pioneers in these efforts was Paul Ehrlich, a German chemist who was studying how different types of chemical dye could selectively stain different tissue types. Ehrlich also noted that some arsenic-based compounds targeted and killed certain pathogens. This observation led him to the concept of the magic bullet, a chemical that would destroy a specific pathogen in an organism without harming the organism itself. The causal agent of syphilis, a kind of bacterium called a spirochete, had been identified in 1905, and Ehrlich and his colleague, Sahashiro Hata, set to work testing hundreds of compounds, trying to find one that would destroy it. The breakthrough came in 1907 with the 606th compound that Hata tested. This compound, later renamed arsphenamine, seemed to be remarkably active against certain bacteria, including the one that causes syphilis. The compound was brought to market in 1910 as Salvarsan. This product and its later derivatives remained the standard treatment for syphilis until the Second World War, and is regarded as the first true modern antimicrobial drug to enter common usage. The success of Salvarsan was a catalyst for further explorations by like-minded chemists. Most notable among these was the discovery in 1932 by scientists at the German company Bayer of sulfonamides, or sulfur drugs, a new class of antimicrobial drugs. These were the first true synthetic antibiotics to come to market, proving to be a breakthrough in treatment, if not a commercial success, for the company that had discovered them. These early advances were built directly on the foundations laid by Koch, Pasteur and others, and firmly validated Ehrlich's early hypothesis about the notion of medicinal magic bullets. Further research grew out of the expertise of scientists working within the German chemical industry on synthetic chemical compounds. But the most significant discovery of the century was to come from an entirely separate line of research, and it came about as the result of a serendipitous accident. The fortuitous discovery of penicillin. As Ehrlich's and the Bayer Company's research efforts were progressing in Germany, a researcher at St. Mary's Hospital in London, Alexander Fleming, was undertaking research into a group of bacteria called staphylococci. His research might never have entered the history books were it not for a series of extraordinary fortuitous coincidences during the summer of 1928, which led to a discovery that would define his career and change modern medicine. When departing on his summer break in August, Fleming left his laboratory in an untidy state. He left an open petri dish, inoculated with Staphylococcus bacteria, beside an open window. In Fleming's absence, the dish became contaminated by a comparatively rare strain of airborne mold, Penicillium notatum. Spores of the mold probably drifted into the laboratory through the open window from an adjacent laboratory where researchers were using molds in their research on the development of vaccines. Because the summer had been unseasonably cool, the staphylococci had barely grown on the plate, and the contaminating mold was able to take hold. After warmer weather returned, the bacteria began to multiply and expand across the plate. But they were inhibited in certain places by the presence of the mold. It was these zones of inhibition around the mold colonies that Fleming discovered when he returned from vacation. Recognizing the significance of the mold's ability to inhibit the bacterial growth, he cultured the mold and collected large quantities of the bacteria-inhibiting substance it produced, which he called mold juice, for further experimentation. Later, after identifying the mold as belonging to the genus Penicillium, he renamed the active substance penicillin. Although Fleming was not the first scientist to have noted the antibacterial properties of Penicillium, he was the first to extract and purify penicillin and to search for further applications. First tests of penicillin. Fleming first used penicillin as an experimental tool to aid his research into the development of an influenza vaccine. He observed that it was ineffective against Haemophilus influenzae, a bacterium believed, wrongly, at the time, to be the cause of influenza. In late 1928, Fleming explored its use in treating infections in blood and human tissue with limited success. These tests appeared to show that penicillin, at least in its impure form, was only effective when delivered at exceptionally high concentrations, too high for patient treatment. Similarly, Fleming's experiments in 1929 on rabbit organs infected with Staphylococcus appeared to show that penicillin would not penetrate beyond the surface of organs. These experiments led to an underestimation of penicillin's value in medicine. Fleming's early tests had a crucial flaw. They tested efficacy against bacteria in the blood and tissue of dead animals, rather than against infections in living animals. Fleming's experiments on live animals were limited to testing low doses for toxicity. In the late 1930s, a team of researchers, led by Ernst Chain and Howard Florey of Oxford University, investigated how penicillin destroyed the cell walls of bacteria. Research that was aided by Fleming's strains of penicillium mold. Chain independently developed a method of extracting penicillin that was similar to that of Fleming, and he reached a number of similar conclusions about the nature of the substance. Crucially, Chain also theorized that the product he had extracted required further purification to increase its potency if it was to be put to therapeutic use. Chain managed to secure 3 years of funding from the UK Medical Research Council shortly after the outbreak of the Second World War in 1939. This was followed by a 5-year, $25,000 grant from the Rockefeller Institute, which had already been funding US-based research into new antimicrobials. These funding commitments, which were very significant investments for their day, brought Chain together with Norman Heatley, with whom he worked further on the purification process. They drew on a newly developed technique from Sweden, freeze-drying, which enabled them to produce small quantities of a fine brown powder to begin testing. The first of these tests began in May 1940 on mice inoculated with lethal doses of Streptococcus bacteria, with startling results. The mice treated with repeated doses of penicillin recovered. The mice that did not receive penicillin or received only a single dose died. These first experiments in animals held significant promise, and Chain and Florey published a paper in the journal Lancet just a few months later. The Oxford team began producing more penicillin, scaling up the process as much as their equipment and facilities allowed, even resorting to improvised production lines using bedpans and milk churns. The limited amounts that Chain's team could produce constrained their ability to begin clinical testing on any scale. Nevertheless, in early 1941, penicillin was tested in humans for the first time, less than a year after being tested in animals for toxicity. The first recipient of penicillin for therapeutic purposes was Albert Alexander, an Oxford police officer who was critically ill with a serious infection and had already lost an eye. Faced with such an ill patient, Florey was persuaded to test the new drug on him. The results were almost as pronounced as those seen in experiments with mice. Over 4 days of treatment with penicillin, Alexander showed rapid improvement, and the infection went into remission. Tragically, the supplies of penicillin were quickly exhausted, and Alexander's condition began to deteriorate again. Less than a month after this relapse, he died. The brief success of Alexander's treatment provided another important indicator of penicillin's enormous potential. But it also underlined the need to find a way to produce larger quantities of the drug. Mass production of penicillin. Supported by the Rockefeller Institute, Florey visited the United States in 1941 and searched for collaborators. In Washington, D.C., he piqued the interest of scientists at the U.S. Department of Agriculture, USDA, who immediately seized upon the potential application of fermentation techniques derived from those used by brewers. Tests began within days at USDA research laboratories, initially using penicillium samples from Oxford. Yields of the mold increased eightfold over the course of the autumn. The success of the work at the USDA laboratories led to a pivotal meeting in New York City in December 1941. Four U.S. pharmaceutical companies, Pfizer, Merck, Squibb, and Lederle, were viewed as having the ability to apply these new fermentation techniques to the large-scale development of penicillin as a therapeutic agent. Merck immediately agreed to a public-private collaboration. Squibb and Pfizer eventually followed suit. A number of other companies, including a collaborative Midwest group of six major pharmaceutical manufacturers, also began development of penicillin, which was being treated as public property rather than as a patented invention. In addition, the US military collected soil samples from locations around the world in an attempt to find strains of penicillium that produced higher concentrations of the precious extract. Promising soil samples were found in Cape Town, Mumbai, and Chongqing. But the best sample came from an overripe melon bought in a Peoria fruit market near the USDA's research laboratory. These efforts, as well as collaboration with UK companies Boots, Glaxo, and Burroughs Wellcome.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.